You want to sing with me?
Yes.
Say chestnuts roasting on an open fire. Huh?
No.
You getting your safety equipment on?
Well,
safety equipment.
No.
So you can reach into the fire.
Okay.
Okay. Anyway, we're going to try and thicken this puppy up by pouring some machinable wax onto it. And then we can actually scrape it down. That's what I got, a plastic bag down there to catch the residue in. If nothing else, we'll pour some on you, right?
No.
Yeah, you're right, because machinable wax is not normal wax. When it gets on you, it sticks like nothing else, and it is much hotter than normal wax, so we just wait for this to finish melting down.
Yeah.
We make a big mess on the floor, aren't we?
Yeah.
Yes.
Hot. It's hot.
It's very hot. And what that doesn't do, a nice sharp blade, once it's cool, will take it off. Yeah. Yeah. Show it to the camera. See? Yeah. What is that? Machinable wax.
Machinable wax.
Machinable.
Machinable
wax.
I like machinable wax.
I like machinable wax too. And we got our second batch ready to go. And it's very close to the combustion point. So, wash my face and pour away. Enough, you can see that it comes off with a razor blade and a very thin sliver.
Yeah, and so let's see if I can get it. By tomorrow, yeah. Let's see. Caden, what are you doing?
Aiden, dancing.
Aiden smelled, inhaled a little bit too much of the fumes. Is that right, Aiden? Let's see your boots. Wow. Okay.
There's what it looked like after 15-20 minutes of scraping on it. Still has some parts that could go down a little lower, but mainly the problem is the edge, getting it filled properly. I'd have to come back if I wanted to use this and do a better job of filling in that edge. Especially back here, you can see those voids. I mean, that's doable. There's a dent. But I'm not sure. Now, where it's... You know, it looks rougher than it is because the way the light shines off of it, but that is really glassy smooth. So the feel of it's good, but I'm not sure about the measurements anyway. I'm thinking I'm going to probably try a piece of MDF in the CNC next and see what we can do as far as competition against this. Out of the machine now, and both sides are cut on it. It's too thick though, but that was kind of intentional. I cut one too thin, so it's like, you know, you're paranoid, so now you're gonna cut it too thick. And we had an oh shit moment right there in the center. The Mach 3 senses when things are going right and wrong in the system, and it shut it down on me for some reason right there. And when I came back out, the computer was running and everything, you just stopped the code from running. And the router had shut down, so it looked like it was in the right position, and I mistakenly just hit start cycle, which means continue on. And that was the wrong thing to do, because I think it thought it was down here. It reads codes ahead in the G code, and I think it thought it was down here, so it lowered the Z axis and started to cut, and I stopped it. But what I should have done, and what I did, you know, to get the rest of it cut, because it was cutting from the top to the bottom, is I scroll back up through the G code on Mach 3, and you can see where it's going to cut. And so once it was back up in this position, that's a change from on the Y axis as well as the X. And so I found that line that had the X and the Y coordinate on it. This may not be the right thing to do, but it's the thing that worked. And then you have a button that says set this to get your next line. And hit go, and man, it went right to that spot, lowered to the right level, and continued on beautifully. So that seems to work. Now what I've done is I've measured it out to figure out how thick it really is. Because, you know, it feels right, but you never know. And sure enough, it's way too thick. Which is good, because I can cut the mistake out. It's going to be deeper than that. And all I did is I picked two points. This one I know what it should be. It should be about half an inch there. And that one, you know, should be off by the same amount. This was put a straight edge across and then measure down from the straight edge to that point. Do the same thing on the other side. And deduct those two from the thickness of the entire stock, which is just a hair over 3 inches. And be sure and, you know, take out for the thickness of the ruler too. You can take it out and then zero the gauge, and that would work. And that comes out to, let's see, it was, that's wrong math. Yeah, here it is, over here on this side. Came out to 0.947, so it's almost an inch thick right there. So plenty of room to lower the bit. So I've got to lower the bit 0.447. So I took this other measurement over here, this point, did the same thing for it. And once I take 0.447 away from it, it'll be 0.365, which is really close to what I want. You know, so about the A-butch on the edge of the blade there. Thin blades are more efficient than thick blades, but I'm willing to give up some efficiency for strength, because when you hit something, if the blade is thicker than the something you hit, you might have a chance that you do all the damage to the thing you hit rather than your blade, which are, you know, obviously a bit of a pain in the ass to replace and build and expensive. So we're going to go with a thicker blade. Anyway, we'll put it back into the machine, lower the cut height, and start another finished cut. Well, it looks like we got ourselves a model of a blade. It's about, at least 3/16 of an inch thick. Okay, we got the blade out of the machine and cut it all sanded down and added a little fillet. The fillet just made out of sawdust and Elmer's glue mixed together. And cut the base out tonight for it. That was also CNC done. And so we think we got a pretty good looking blade there. So here's our Hundersten controllable pitch hub, and it's still all nasty and dirty and everything, but it's got three places where these blades will mount, and this blade goes just like that. So when we're sailing along, that's in a feathered position. The water has some profile that it's going to hit, so it's not beautifully efficient for sailing, but it's designed to be more efficient for motoring when you're actually burning diesel, which costs money. And so most of the time when we're motoring forward, it will rotate into this pitch or angled attack. And so this blade's going that direction. It's pushing water out this way. This is the face. This is the back. You're on the forward end of the boat where you are now. And then the hub can turn the blade so that it's feathered for sailing, or keep on turning it. And now the blade is still turning that direction, but it's catching water and pushing it that direction, so this is its reverse mode. And all three blades move in concert with each other. So that's why we're taking being so painful about trying to get a really good blade for this system, because it's a really good system if it has decent blades. So hence all the time and effort. It'll be worth it. That's what we do for now. We're gonna give it a coat of paint. And then we'll probably be able to see some imperfections once we get some paint on it. We can add a little fill where it might need it. Get it as perfect as we can, and we've got our pattern to cast. So the next thing to do is start making we'll figure out how much volume it is, figure out how much big a crucible I need, maybe even build a new furnace, on and on and on and on. So come back.